Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. He just put a lot of pressure on the panelists. Innovations in retail, 21st century ideas, you know, what is the customer of the future going to want? Well, the reality is we have to live with what we know today. And between the four of them, they do know a lot about the various spheres in which they operate. I'm going to zip my lips for now because you have four presentations coming up. David, you go first.
Gentlemen, good afternoon. It's an absolute delight to be here in Mumbai this afternoon. I'm going to speak for a few moments on something which I'm personally very passionate about, something which we spend an awful lot of time at Benoy perfecting and getting right, and that is the art of placemaking. We might call it the art of creating destinations, the innovation of creating destinations, or I suppose if at its very basic we might call it the art of creating places that people want to go to, that people want to spend time in, and that people want to come back to time and time again. Why does it matter, of course? Well, we all know why it matters. It matters because dwell time is important in terms of revenue, not only for landlords, but also for retailers. The longer people stay in our destinations, the more they invariably tend to spend, the more times they may well take time to have a meal or go for a drink or go to the cinema. So creating locations that people are passionate about, that people feel belong to them, is very important. Now, if we look at the history of retail architecture over the last 20 years, and certainly as we have seen it very closely in the United Kingdom, you know, we've gone on the one hand from inward-looking 1970s isolated mall design, and we've made a progress, and certainly in the last five or so years, to retail schemes, retail destinations that are mixed use, that are higher density, that are better connected into our city centres. And we can see that certainly in our own work. And we're an organisation that we're about 500 strong. We operate around the world. We have 9 offices. And I have the privilege of leading our London studio. And our projects have gone from inward-looking, isolated is the wrong word, but they're out-of-town shopping developments such as Bluewater. We've gone to schemes like the Bullring in Birmingham in the UK, which are much better connected, stitched into their towns and city centres, to Westfield London, an iconic powerhouse of retail, incredibly well connected into the infrastructure of its city. Schemes like St David's, Cardiff, in the capital of Wales. We've done other things as well, and you may well have come across this scheme, the Ferrari World Leisure Scheme, if you've been to the Middle East. In Asia, we've done schemes like Elements, Kowloon Station in Hong Kong, more of that later. We've done Iron Orchard in Singapore, and we've done the Shanghai ICC. They're all well-connected, integrated schemes, absolutely central to the city centre locations that they are part of. A little bit closer to home, our first scheme in India, DLF Place, Sackett, New Delhi, and a scheme that we currently have on the drawing board, which is Supernova in Noida. Again, all beautifully connected schemes that are full of powerhouse retail. They're mixed use, they're high density. I'm going to come on to Cabot Circus a bit later, because this is a scheme that we delivered back in the UK, and that has a special importance, particularly in terms of this debate, which is about the innovation of placemaking. We want to know, what is innovation? Well, innovation is all of these things. It's about the shopping, it's about eating, it's about leisure, it's about the environment that we sit in. It's about watching performances, it's about just taking in the ambience of a location. Yeah, sure, it's about creating shopping destinations, and these guys are going to talk a little bit more about their own sphere. So, you know, retail architecture is about the frame that goes around a beautiful picture. It's about creating that location into which great retailing destinations can be located. Now, at Benoy, we use a phrase that we use quite often called urban tactics, and it's really just code for a whole series of different initiatives that we can bring to our retail schemes that don't necessarily require every single piece to be part of, but we know that if we get more of these urban tactics in as part of our scheme, then we stand a better chance of actually making a scheme that has longevity, that will have value to not only to its investors, as we were hearing in the previous discussion, but also and primarily to customers and retailers. Now, I won't necessarily read out all of these, but there are seven different urban tactics that I very quickly want to go through today. Now, like all good architects, I've put in far too many slides for the time that we have, so I'm going to go through them quite quickly. If when we get to the end you think, oh, yeah, I quite like that scheme, that, and he didn't say what it was, please do come and see me. I'll do my best to try and explain it in a little bit more detail. So I think item number one, and absolutely key in the Indian context, certainly from my experience and our experience at Benoyam working in India since 2005, is about integration into the city. And what does it mean? Well, it means this seamless transition between spaces. We want our retail schemes, we want our developments to feel absolutely integrated into its city centre and town centre locations. You know, all too often we see isolated developments that feel like little oases, if you like. And while they're good and intrinsically valuable, they'd be ever so much more valuable if they were better connected into the city centres in which they were located. And we use this diagram on a scheme back in the UK, which really was trying to explain to the client that if we could create a heart into our development that was part of a city centre scheme, then it would be so much more valuable in terms of its contribution to the city. And it doesn't matter where you are in the world. You may be in the US, as in this case in Santa Monica. You might be in Liverpool, in the United Kingdom. But it's about creating schemes that are integrated into the city. Before we did the Bullring scheme in the United Kingdom, the previous Bullring scheme was isolated by almost like a six-lane highway. And we buried that highway and we created land bridges that connected this scheme back into the city centre. And now it makes a positive contribution to the world within which it sits. And all of these schemes that I'm showing on the slides now all have that intrinsic value to them. They're better integrated into the city centre. So that's one of the innovations that we want to bring to our schemes here in India, here in Asia, and back home in Europe. We want to exploit existing assets. And really that means making the most of your environment. We have some fabulous buildings in Europe. We have some fabulous buildings here in India. Let's bring those. Let's stitch them into our city centres. You know, someone once famously said, to know where you're going, you need to know where you came from. And so making the most of the environment means stitching in and integrating historic buildings. It may be a set-piece building like a church or a temple, this example's in Birmingham, but it might be something vernacular and small, a little alleyways, tiny little vernacular buildings that you can build into your retail developments, into your mixed-use developments, to make them more authentic, to make them feel as if they're part of their city centre locations. And you are blessed with some absolutely beautiful buildings in India. And it's a crying shame if we can't make the most of that fabric that we already have. It might not be buildings. It might be waterfront. It might be beautiful views from high-level buildings. All of these things we need to make the most of. But ultimately, it might just be about creating beautiful spaces in which people want to spend time. And it goes back to that point about creating and insisting and making sure that you're encouraging people to dwell more in your city centres, in your retail schemes. So we want to externalise our schemes. We don't want them to be inward-looking developments. And that means creating streets and squares. And streets and squares is another of those useful little phrases that we use to define and help us to explain to people what it is that we want to do. If you go back right to the very beginning of European retail design, it's really about arcaded routes between different streets. And this is an example in Milan that's often cited as the first shopping centre in Europe. And we can see that in some of the buildings that we've done much later in the 20th and 21st centuries. And we can see that in the work of our colleagues here in Liverpool. This is the Liverpool One scheme, an absolute powerhouse of retail that was central to the regeneration of a city centre that had really fallen down on its luck. And it was part of an initiative that was government-led that said, you know, we can do something better in this location. But it wasn't isolated, it wasn't inward-looking, it was very much external. It might be historic buildings, it might be waterfront. There are a whole host of different ways that we can create externalised schemes that actually say a whole much more to the outside world as well as they do to the environment that they're creating within. We've talked a little bit in previous sessions about sustainability, and we can do some really clever things now, and we should be doing that to make our buildings fit better into our environment. So, The environment's public realm, of course, and we want to make sure that we create great places for people. That's what it's about, because if we create great places for people, they'll come back time and time again. It might be about gathering spaces for city workers to have their lunch. It might be about gathering spaces for festivals, for city and civic occasions. It might be internal spaces, as this example at Westfield London. Or it might be spaces that are fun and that are interesting. This is Heron City Plaza in Madrid. It's about theatre. It's about something that goes beyond the ordinary, the everyday. It might be like this. This is Masdar City in Abu Dhabi. It's a scheme on the drawing board. It's all about creating internal, external spaces that are conditioned, that don't use too much energy, that are sustainable. I'm really curious to see how this scheme develops when it's finally built out. And one of my favourites, Clark Quay in Singapore. It's theatrical. It's over the top. It's a superb place. It's a gathering place. It's where young people are brought together to spend their time. It's a really great location, and people go back time and time again, and retailers do well in this location. Roofscapes, the fifth elevation. You know, we look down on a lot of our buildings. Roofscapes shouldn't be just a place where we allow our M&E engineers to put a whole load of kit, a whole load of plant. We can do so many things to extend the offer. You know, we can make places like Vivo City in Singapore. They're great promenading locations, and we use the roof to great effect if we can think creatively about the places that we create. It might be an animated roofscape. It might be a roof garden and spa terrace, as the Iron Orchard scheme in Singapore. This is Elements Mall in Hong Kong. Before we came on board onto this project, the roofscape really hadn't been thought about, but now it's an absolutely integral part of the offer, because all of those customers that are in the retail centres below go up to the roofscape. The 60,000 people that work and live in the office towers and the resi towers that sit above come down to the roofscape. It's an outdoor garden. It's a beautiful place to eat. It's a beautiful place to drink and to be seen. And Namba Parks, Osaka in Japan, it's a fantastic scheme. It's well landscaped. The roofscape is an integral part of the offer. And so we quite often use this diagram, the umbrella roof typology, and we say to clients, look, you don't necessarily need to make your centres air-conditioned. We might use a roof typology that allows us to create places that are both internal, both external. They may be semi-air-conditioned, they may be just tempered, they might not be air-conditioned at all. You know, we know that that saves on the service charge or the CAM in India. You know, and not all of our centres will get this far, but some of them might. And we're working with some clients at the moment who really buy into this vision that you can create town centre locations that are both inside and outside. And we're working at the moment with a client in Bangalore called Kale Infra that have exactly that vision. And it's about being creative and innovative in terms of how we construct our retail, our mixed-use developments. So we might integrate our transport links. It's a big issue in the UK, it's a big issue in Europe, and it's certainly a big issue here in India. And why is it important? Because it's not rocket science, of course it's not. It's about creating footfall. It's about creating transport links, and all of our best schemes have been absolutely integral to the transport network that they serve and that they're located with. And it might not be an expensive metro. It may well be a light rail system, as in this scheme in the Czech Republic. But it might be about something simple like rickshaws and bicycles, and making sure that you design those into the schemes that you're looking to and at. And finally, Westfield London. If you've not been it, if you take a trip to London, go and have a look at Westfield London. It's beautifully integrated. It's absolutely part of the public transport network. And almost 55% of the people that go to Westfield London arrive by public transport, which for the UK is an absolutely astounding figure. And it works beautifully well. And so finally, we've got to integrate our entertainment, our leisure, our sport, and our eating. We want to create destinations. We want to create places that are exciting, not because we're feeling generous, but because destinations that use their spaces creatively create revenue. In the same way that you know that you've got to create revenue from your malls, you can create revenue from your external spaces. And it might just be something really simple as a beautiful boulevard on which you place restaurants. But it might be a creative food village. It might be chef-branded fine dining. It might be in-mall dining. But it might be about festivals and civic occasions. and at the Bullring, the square that they created there is now part of the civic environment of the city centre. It's where the city goes when they want to celebrate important festivals and occasions during the year. So it's not just a retailing location, it's a civic location too. We've done it in other places such as Thailand, and we've done it certainly in Ferrari World in Abu Dhabi. Now, not every scheme will necessarily be able to create something as lavish and as big as this, but on a smaller scale, every scheme can be creative and can create revenue from their places. And it's about creating places for these guys, making them feel ownership of shopping centres and retail developments, both internal and external. It might be about art too. It might be about leisure concepts and creating great places for people just to be in. So finally, it's about these guys. It's about the cheeky little guy in the centre. It's about his mum and his dad and their extended family. And it's about making places that they feel comfortable in, that they feel ownership of, and places that they feel that they want to come back to time and time again. Thank you.
David, thank you. Well, from location innovation to innovation within organisations, innovations by managers, I think it's time to change gears just a little bit, and I'd like to invite Niren Chaudhary, Managing Director, Yum Restaurants International, for his presentation.
So good evening. My name is Niren. I work with Yum Restaurants, which is KFC, Pizza Hut, and Taco Bell. And it's a real privilege to be here in front of you today to talk about innovation, one of my favorite topics. So I'm going to break up my chat in two parts. One, I will talk to you about what innovation means to me, and then the challenges and the difficulty of innovation. And then secondly, share with you a framework to think about innovation, and hopefully something that you can take away and perhaps think of the relevance of that in your own businesses. So first, what does innovation mean, and what are some of the challenges with innovation? And then a framework with some examples from our brands on how we are working to make that come alive. So for me, innovation is our ability to ensure that in an ever-changing, dramatic world, we work to ensure the ongoing relevance of our brands and ensuring that our business models continue to be strong. So whatever that takes to ensure ongoing relevance for our brands is what innovation means to me. And innovation can be thought of in two ways. One is sustaining innovation, and the other one is disruptive innovation. So sustaining innovation is innovation that we do to optimize and grow your existing business model, your existing offerings to existing consumers, optimize that, make that more and more tighter and more productive. So that is sustaining innovation, which is to do with the existing business model. And then you have disruptive innovation, which is creating a totally new business model. And I have to say to you that companies that do not disruptively innovate can very, very quickly become irrelevant. And therefore, if innovation is required to ensure ongoing relevance, I think it is important for companies to find out ways to do both sustaining but also disruptive innovation. Now, the question to ask is it possible for the same company to be great at sustaining innovation, which is to do with your existing business model, and also at the same time get disruptive? Well, corporate history would have it that it is rather difficult, because sustaining innovation actually is about talking to your existing consumers, listening to your existing consumers, responding to your existing consumers, and optimizing what you already know. And disruptive actually requires you not to listen to your consumers, not to do what your existing consumers want, but almost do something which is completely, might appear to be intuitive. And therein lies the dilemma of innovation between sustaining and disruptive. And like I said, corporate history has it that if you're not good at disruptive innovation, you can actually be made irrelevant very quickly. So let's look at some examples. IBM. IBM was great at doing sustaining innovation. They were in the business of mainframes. They made better and better and better mainframes. And then out of the blue came in Dell with personal computers and completely knocked them off. Another example is Nokia, leaders in mobile telephones with keypads. They focused on existing customers, listened to existing customers, and did whatever they said. And out of the blue came the smartphone from Samsung without any keypads and completely dislodged them from leadership. Another example of sustaining innovation is Sony. Sony, first to market with Walkman, leader in electronics, made better and better Walkman. And then you had Apple coming in from the outside with iPod. So therefore, sustaining innovation, which is about satisfying your existing customers, is important, but may not be sufficient to ensure ongoing relevance of our consumer value proposition in a world that is changing so dramatically. So the question, therefore, is why is it difficult for companies to do both sustaining and disruptive innovation at the same time? Is it possible? I think the difficulty is that innovation is a function of the resources, the process, the value system, and the culture that a company has. And when the company is focused on doing what the textbook definition is on marketing, which is listen to your customer and do what the customer says, you're unfortunately stuck in that paradigm of sustaining innovation. You almost have to throw away the textbook and say, I will not listen to customers all the time. I will do that for a big chunk of my business, but I will also find ways not to listen to them and actually innovate in an inside-outside manner by getting inspired. And I want to share with you two ways in which we are trying to do that with our brands at Yum. And I think the two ways that I want to share with you as a framework and perhaps useful for you to think, is that relevant for your business, are the following. One is that we need to think about innovation not only as product innovation, but innovation in a much broader sense. And I will expand on that. And the second piece is that we need to ensure we are creating a culture that encourages not only sustaining innovation, but also disruptive thinking. So two components. One is a broader framework of innovation, not just product focused. And the second one is to also have a culture of innovation that can drive it. So let me share with you some examples of both of these from our brands. So first, broader scope of innovation. Innovation is not just about products. So once you have nailed your consumer value proposition, what I mean to say is that you need to think of innovation in a much broader sense, in four areas. Firstly, innovation around your business model. Secondly, innovation around process. Thirdly, innovation around products. And fourth, innovation around the overall experience that supports your consumer value proposition. So I'm going to walk through each one of these and give you some examples to bring it to life. So to recap, the first one is business model. Second, process, third, product, and fourth, experience. And what I'm saying is that we need to have a much broader agenda on innovation to be able to enhance the chances of our company being able to drive disruptive thinking. So on business model, first let's take business model. Business model for me is finding out new ways to capture value from consumers. And I have to say that India is a rather unique economic environment where best practices do not seem to be adequate. You have to think of a next practice, because in the Indian environment, you have a unique combination of first world costs like rentals for retail businesses. As you're aware, the rentals in Delhi and Mumbai are more expensive than New York and Paris. And on the other hand, you have third world affordability. So how do you really make this business model work? High cost environment and low affordability would imply that you have to innovate on the business model. You have to think about a business model which is perhaps based on modest margins but very high asset turn, which means we have to think of ways to be able to leverage our asset investment. So some examples: as retail businesses in the food business, you want to be able to think, how can I make my concept more and more broadly relevant? Can I use it for multiple day parts, for lunch, for snacking, for late nights, for dinner? Can I make my concept so broad that I attract, as we do in KFC, people who want to have a beverage or dessert or vegetarian or indeed chicken? Can I, in Pizza Hut, have people come into me not only for pizza but also for pasta and a whole lot more? So some examples of the need to think about business model innovation as the first part of thinking innovation in a much broader sense. The second one is about process. Process is, to me, all about cost optimization and driving control. So are we thinking hard enough of how can we strengthen the process in our execution of the consumer value proposition, both in terms of using technology? Do we have the right ERP system? Do I have the right point of sale systems? Are they integrated in the most efficient way to a central data warehouse that I can mine? Do I have good control ERP systems in place? Am I actually also driving some vendor synergies to drive their efficiency and thereby lowering costs for me and strengthening my business model? So the first one was business model innovation. The second one around process innovation. The third one is my favorite, and I think most of us relate to that, is product innovation. And let me talk to you about product innovation in the context of the food business. I think in the context of the food business, our unique insight has been that in India, you have to be a global brand, but you must have a local heart. You have to have a local heart. So that is the overarching permeating thought. And then on product, I believe we need to think of product innovation at three levels. One is core product innovation, which is product improvements for existing customers. So some examples are, we've taken some of our core products like hot wings, like popcorn chicken, or like pizza, and then customize those products with sprinkles or with Indian tandoori sauce and made them relevant for the Indian consumer. So the first piece is core product innovation. The second one is about adjacent innovation in products, which is improvements in existing products, but for new customers, not for existing customers. And here we have launched concepts like Streetwise program in KFC, where students can come in and access the world of KFC at about 25 rupees. Or the weekday special in Pizza Hut, where you can access the brand at about 99 rupees. So adjacent innovation in products, so you can offer your existing products to new customers. And then finally is the disruptive area of product innovation, which is totally new products for totally new consumers. And here I think two examples, good examples are, one is Taco Bell. I don't know how many of you are familiar with Taco Bell. It's a Mexican-inspired eating concept, which has got all kinds of new flavors and textures and formats and quesadillas and burritos and crunch wraps, a totally different way of for consumers to eat food. And then we have the Crushers innovation in KFC, or the vegetarian products in KFC, which are totally new products for totally new consumers. So some examples on product innovation in three levels: core, second is adjacent, and third is disruptive. So I've talked about three aspects of a broader focus on innovation. The first one was business model. The second one was process. The third was product. And the fourth one is about experience. And I think bringing the experience to life in a 360 sense for our consumers against delivery of that consumer value proposition. Two examples. One is, are we leveraging technology enough? So in our brands, we're using digital menu boards. We have self-order kiosks for customers. We're working on online ordering for our customers. The full gamut of digital and social media are examples of how you can innovate to strengthen the execution and the experience around your customer value proposition. The second one is around channels. Are we looking aggressively about new channels to deliver the value proposition in a convenient way to our consumers? So for example, outlets on the highways, delivery outlets, food court outlets, outlets in airports, store-in-store concepts, and so on. So these are the four aspects of innovation, I believe, that if a company is able to structure a framework, which is a broader framework on business model, on process, on product and experience, I think you create the groundwork and an agenda for an innovation practice which is not only sustaining, but could also be disruptive. And finally, the second aspect of the framework I talked to you about is the culture of innovation. So at Yum, we have a unique achieving breakthrough results training program on innovation, mindset innovation, that we train everybody in the organization on. It's a two-day program. And we teach all of our employees how to think disruptively. And we encourage divergence, we encourage contradictions, and leveraging contradictions to create innovation. So for example, can I create great-looking restaurants that are cheap to build? Can I have great customer service even at low employee costs? And so on. So we leverage this whole mindset of being able to drive disruptive thinking through this training program that we have at Yum. So therefore, creating a culture of innovation where you encourage people to be somewhat of mavericks for a certain percent of the time, where they stop listening to consumers and actually follow their gut and intuition in terms of what might potentially excite customers in the future, I think is hugely important. And therefore, linked to that, we need to think, what are the ways in which I can improve the ability of my company to increase my ability to anticipate the future, to create greater intellectual flexibility in my organization, and drive much higher levels of experimentation in the company so that I can create a culture that, drives not only sustaining, but also disruptive innovation. So that was what I wanted to share with you. As a context, the importance of innovation and what is difficult, which is the same companies are unlikely and very often not able to do both, sustaining and disruptive, and the framework on what I believe is a way forward, which is think of innovation in a broader sense and make sure that we create a culture in which our employees are encouraged to think more disruptively. Thanks.
Niren, thank you. This is flowing perfectly because we're going to go from innovation within organizations, among teams, to really thinking out of the box to capture the imagination of the consumer. Ram Iyer of Vodafone now.
Ladies and gentlemen, I think Niren has perfectly set the context from a company perspective in terms of innovation. What I'm going to talk about is a little bit about the how, what, and you know why of innovation. So let's start first with the why. And I think especially in telecoms, the industry that I work in, business is like a hurricane. You know, so you definitely have new news happening almost every day. There's so much of impact that happens. But let me begin with an anecdote from this book, which is Black Swan. You know, I think many of us would have read the book Black Swan. And there's an anecdote of a Thanksgiving turkey, you know, which is, it all talks about, you know, based on everything that the turkey knows, based on historical data, based on its past experiences, you know, the turkey continues to have a happy life. It tends to have a nice time, it's moving around, it's having great food, and its life is great, you know, for the turkey. But one afternoon in autumn, suddenly, surprise, bolt out of the blue, the turkey realizes it's a sitting duck. So in that sense, you know, I think what's extremely important is to really understand that it is extremely critical for companies to look outside the context and really understand the need to differentiate. Because if you don't look outside the context and if you're going to be defined by what your past experiences are, you're likely to become that Thanksgiving turkey and die. You know, so therefore, innovation becomes extremely critical for a company. In my mind, I think, to put it very simply, if one has to look at innovation, I think there are two components to this piece. And the first one is all about having a very sharp insight. You know, it's all about going beyond the four walls of your business and actually looking at consumers. It might be more in the realm of sustaining innovation, but it all starts by actually going beyond the four walls of your business and really looking at consumers and trying to get what is that deep insight that we are trying to address? And then doing all it takes to create a impact. In terms of an approach, I think this is what we love to do in Vodafone. We say that it's all about a head in the cloud, so trying to do something radically different, yet delivering something which is real. You know, so it's important that in terms of the communication, in terms of the messaging, there is something which is real, which the consumer can really connect in terms of feet on the ground. So I'm going to take two examples to really drive home this point, because the idea is to give you some examples from the business. And Vodafone, I think, is known for its Zuzus, you know, which is what is one of our most innovative iconography or property that we've created. And this was a real challenge which we had way back. The IPL was a fantastic property. offering appointment viewing, but I think the biggest challenge which we had to address is that there was going to be viewer fatigue, you know, because you have matches happening, you have several matches happening, so you have to really bring something new for consumers in order to keep their interest going. So what I'd like to show you is a small film in terms of a navy, which talks about the birth of the Zuzu and how it created both an insight and the impact. So can I have the navy?
And he'll be signing the ball for Hummet.
Vodafone Zoo Zoo. Hamper chahiye aapko. Phone lagaiye 6694393.
Phone here in South Africa to watch the cricket. You guys want to say hello to your fans back home?
That was the birth of the Zuzu, and that brings me to the next case which I want to bring to. It's about is when we launched 3G services. So, you know, the insight which we found was most important for consumers was the fact that the key barrier for internet usage was actually poor experience because of speed. You know, it's just the perception that internet on mobile is slow. So we addressed this through the Super Zuzu. So can we have the AV, please?
sorry. Ajabo. Unjo karapre. Terebri ninjo ba. Ajabo da tare. Ijo ijo. Atsu. Bere salando. Jakura. Gele. Honey. Tukuri. Hamsku. Wakana.
One hero, one mission. To save the world from the jaws of slow internet. From the suffering of buffering.
To Comeritico, Fum, Tulini, Papa, Mestu Dolo Guna, Ka Jumin Jin Junale Baboku!
Ram, thanks very much. You may have wonderful stories to tell, but how and where you tell them matters equally. Experience matters, as Roshni from Disney underlines.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Roshni Bakshi, and I head the consumer business of the Walt Disney Company. For us, the consumer, so let me just kind of, I think my computer is giving a little bit of trouble. Yep. So we are a company, as you all know, the Walt Disney Company very well. We're a company that really believes in telling stories. So for us, all our brands are built around stories, stories that really make you laugh, cry, and celebrate. Therefore, in everything that we do, including in across all our platforms, we try and tell a story, and through that, let the consumers experience our brand. Stories really allow our consumers to connect with the brand. That, to us, therefore, magic becomes an important part when the consumer truly emotionally connects and has a very a long-term and a lifelong connection with the brand. So really, we say magic happens when the consumer builds an emotional brand, emotional bond with our brands and our stories. So let me show you a short video that really shows how consumers truly develop a connection and therefore a bond with our characters, our stories, and therefore with the products that we sell.
Hi, Daddy.
Hey, sport. You're up early.
Where are you going, Daddy?
I'm going on a business trip.
Is Mommy going with you?
No, Mommy's going to stay home with you.
That's good. Are any of your friends going?
Nope, I'm going all by myself.
Won't you be lonely?
Lonely? Who, me?
Our storytelling really cuts across different platforms. So we may start our story through a movie, through a live event, through television, through publishing, where you know our stories come emerge from there, or through digital and online. And then, of course, try and put it all together through the consumer products side, which is really about products that consumers take home that continue to carry that experience and that story that they have with them. So really for us, retail is just an extension of the platform, of one of the platforms through which we tell our stories. And that's really what we try and do at retail. So when I was given the topic of innovations at retail, I really put together what we do across the world, which is tell stories and innovate constantly so that our consumers come in and really look at retail not just as a place that we put our products up for selling, but more as a place where they can truly come in and live and breathe some of the stories that they have read, seen, experienced in the park. And then buying a product just becomes an extension of the experience that they have had. So we redid our Disney stores in the US and renamed them imagination centers more than stores, right? This is really where a consumer walks in, where the store talks to the consumer. So lights change every day. There are things happening. There are stories being told for children that come in. There's a place that kids can go and dress up and make over. So then it's not just about coming there once to pick up a product anymore. It's a place where the consumer, the family wants to come back again and again, because that's really the place that they believe is a place that they can call their own, right? And to me, I think that's a big part of really saying, how do you get a consumer engaged constantly with your brand? However, we also do a lot of work across the world with retailers in different formats. While we're truly aspirational as a brand, we're there in hypermarkets like Walmart. We're there across departmental stores. We're present within a lot of specialty stores, whether it's a Toys R Us or whether it's Hamleys across the world or any of the other formats. And in each of those formats, what we try and do is looking at the format and the presence that we have there, we actually try and put together little stories. So for example, these are two different look and feel of our own brand. So one is the princess, where you can see the castle, you can see where the kid actually enters, she can go inside a place. There's a mirror that kind of changes and makes her look like a little princess because her dress comes on with her reflection there, or indeed on the left side, which is another, you know, a story of ours, which a television series that we've put out called Mickey Mouse Clubhouse, and we sell a lot of products around it. Here again, what we've done is let the little child, because this is, you know, at a consumer that's a lot younger, to be able to go through and really have learning as part of the entire section. So these are simple sections that are there in retail stores, but each one of them tells a story. And there are more examples. So cars, we've actually tried to create garages across, you know, in various retail formats. Or a place where kids can just come and race and play around with the products and actually believe that they're racing car drivers. Or indeed the castle, which is, you know, one of the most endearing images that people have when they think about Disney. Here again, this is about Snow White. So this is a set of products that, you know, you sell for Snow White. So Snow White is all about the apple. So we've actually tried to create spaces within stores where, you know, kids can enter a door and it's like a forbidden door and, you know, there is an experience there. So whether it is, we try and do it through the entire, just the kind of, the places that we create, or sometimes even the touch feel experiences that we have there, as well as in many other cases where we have the capability to do what is called as interactive technology within the stores that allows consumers to really touch, feel, and get different experiences and therefore see parts of the stories or put themselves in the place of, let's say, the character, or even through sights and smells. We are a young company in India. We've been here for the last 6 years. And with the retailers and the retail formats that we have, we've started bringing some of these stories to life. So whether it's in the form of a princess area, so each of these places, what we try and do, even in India, is to say, how do we work with our retail partners? How do we really put things together so that each retail partner, depending upon the kind of store and the kind of format that they have and the consumer that they bring in, are able to create an experience? So for us, truly, these are places that our consumers come in and spend time, and our partners enjoy having us as part of the entire format that they have. So whether it's a Hamleys or whether it's Lifestyle or Landmark or Crosswords or any of our other modern trade partners, we have different kind of look and feel that we create. So this is just a place where kids can just stand there, pull out toys, and we have merchandisers that we keep there, so who are constantly putting these toys back. So we allow consumers all the time to believe that they have the right to touch, to pull, to actually do what they want, and then we place it back so that every time a new consumer comes there, the experience remains the same. Or indeed, a place that they can go in. Even, and we sell diverse categories, so this makes it even more interesting and challenging, from apparel to baby and infant gear, to toys, to plates, to back-to-school products. So in each of this, we have to really look at with our characters, with our stories, and yet with the kind of products, how do we really create those small places in stores where the consumer just doesn't come in to pick a product and go off, because then we'll never get that consumer to keep coming back again. But for us, it's all about how does that consumer come back? Why would that consumer want to keep coming back into those places? So it's just some of the other examples that we have done. Or even we've started now putting in place what we call as some of our favorite characters, where kids can come in and they just take photographs with these, you know, large iconic images that are there, and they believe that they've had their touch feel of the character. So we've taken it to the next level, and we've looked at retail spaces in India not only as places where people come to buy, but also where people come to spend a day, to bring their families, to say, okay, this is my way of, you know, actually having a day out with the family. And we looked at that and said, how do we bring more experiences to our consumers while they're within the retail area, may not be within the store, but within the malls. And therefore, we started bringing in our characters and actually making them enact parts of the stories. So we had Cinderella over last year, and we're getting our characters one by one. We have Mickey coming in, and each of these give the opportunity for our consumers and our fans to really touch, feel, be part of the story, and to actually interact with our characters. So more than 500,000 people last year, and our kids and families, experienced the magic of the Disney Princess. Now what we're doing is we've taken the innovation. So for us, it's about when we actually talk about retail, we're taking it now to the next step and saying, okay, so consumers come in, they experience, they touch, feel, they see the stories, they buy the products, right, at the end of the day, or they come in to see our characters, to see the events, and they get more and more connected and engaged with our brands. But what's the one thing that consumers will remember throughout their lives, especially if they're kids today, they are going to be our consumers tomorrow as well as they grow up. And therefore, we've started creating what we call as memories for them and special memories. So with some of our retail partners, especially the specialty stores, the toy stores, we've started now implementing what we call as allowing these stores to have birthday parties that we manage through our partners, where kids can come in and the entire store is theirs for them and their friends. So not only they have a little party, but also have a run of the store, buy any product that they want. Now this helps us, and it also works for our retail partner, because in both the cases, I mean, the child comes in because it's a Disney birthday party and it's a princess birthday party or a Spider-Man birthday party. But then at the end of the day, it's a magical day, because what better than a child in a toy store? So these are just some of the things that we are doing. And truly we work with what Walt Disney's, what one of the favorite sayings that he had, that time and conditions change so rapidly that we must focus constantly on the future. And while our stories are enduring, we need to innovate, for the consumer needs keep changing. And the way they actually build connections, given there's so much happening across in terms of just technology, in terms of just mind space that, let's say, our kids today have, and the time that they have even to remember, we need to be constantly innovating and making them feel special. So that's really what we do. Thank you.
Roshni, thank you. I have to say that through all your presentations, I really was transported. But now I have to play the role of skeptic and a couple of questions coming your way before we open this up to the audience. Before I forget, I think I should thank you. You all have all been very disciplined about the time allotted to you to make your point. David, if I can start with you first. Those were captivating images of places and you know, how to create spaces that engage. But in India, your fundamental constraint is you don't have those large tracts of land to play with. You have to make do, work around, circumvent issues. How much of that can you really apply to India?
This is going to sound like a shameless plug for master planning, but I think that wherever we are in the world, there are always constraints. You know, we're never offered an ideal scenario in which a sort of a prime piece of virgin land is offered up to you. So there are always constraints, and I think you have to work around those constraints, and you have to work with those constraints. And that's why, you know, one of the key points was about working with the assets that you have. But if you have, you know, if you have a big piece of land, and a lot of this comes back to city authorities, in spending time to make sure that they master plan and forward think in terms of how their city is going to develop. And in that way, the job for the developer is made that much more easy.
You know, because you talked about integrating, and I'll just talk about Delhi as an example, where we've had over the last, remember the number of years exactly, but over the last 7 years or so, the development of the metro and simultaneous development of mall projects, new ones. Yet, correct me if I'm wrong, I don't see any integration or any communication or planning that has taken place in an instance where it could have. And perhaps it's unfair to rope you into this discussion, but you know, there doesn't seem to be that much focus on integration right now in India.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not that familiar with Delhi, but I'm more familiar with Bangalore, where they're not developing a metro system, but they're developing an elevated train service. And they've got a real opportunity there to make sure that their development that happens associated with the rail system is linked into it. I mean, it's so simple, it's almost obvious. And it should happen. There's no reason why it shouldn't
and
happen.
And yet sometimes it doesn't. But Roshni, it ties in with some of the images that we saw in your presentation as well. While there was a larger, grander scale for examples of how, you know, the in-store experience overseas, you could see it coming down in size and proportion in India. So you're too sort of trimming down, scaling down, applying some of your experiences there, but a more modest version here, or am I misstating the point?
No, actually, I would say that, you know, I would take from what Niren was saying as one of the things in terms of business model innovation. So what we've really done here is to look at, yes, we'd love to bring some of that size and scale into this country, but really we're looking at ultimately what's the space available to retail. Again, he made a very interesting point where he said there is, you know, first world costs and third world affordability, and yet when people look at it, the experience needs to be the same. You cannot, therefore, assume that the experience that you provide to the consumers has to be third world because their affordability is third world. So what we've only tried to do is maybe reduce the size, but not the experience. Not the look and feel and the final, you know, what the consumer gets, but just in terms of size and scale, if something was over 5,000 square feet, in a section here within a store, because the store
it
itself...
It diminishes impact, though, you will
not,
have to admit.
Not really. So if the entire store is 30,000 square feet, and you get 1,000 as a section within, how you would do the section, it will be slightly... It's just what I would call as a Walkman version okay. of the large radio. But you're not creating a different experience,
okay.
Which is in any fashion compromised.
I think one of the contexts also in India is that, remember, India is primarily a country of the youth. More than 60% of the population is less than 30 years of age. And the youth are also over-indexed on literacy. Therefore, the youth actually aspire more, demand more, and expect a lot more. And therefore, in this environment, I think the challenge for all brand thinkers and corporates is how do you really, given all the constraints of real estate, availability, space, etc., not compromise on that experience for the consumer. So stay aspirational. How do you really make your brands aspirational? Because they have to be youthful and aspirational to really work, given the macroeconomic demographics of the country.
Niren, I'm going to stay with you for a second because, you know, you were talking about disruptive innovation. Is there any way to measure the risk and, you know, draw on your personal experiences here, measure the risk of that disruptive innovation, you know, basically lay out the roadmap for how you would go about that, because surely there's got to be risk there.
Yeah, so I think, first, I think the mindset of recognizing that one does not only have to listen to customers, but there's also a point in time when you have to stop listening to customers. I think that's a big shift for corporates. And normally, I think people say that still 70 to 80% of the focus of the resources and the process and your culture has to be on the existing business model. But you have to create almost a 20, 30% focus on what might be the future. And the only way to do that is to resource it, and also with the right people and also with the funding. So you're encouraging this nonstop creativity and a lot of experimentation. And to your point on how do you really manage the costs of that, I think my own experience is that one can leverage technology very effectively. State-of-the-art business analytics that now exist, which are more forward-looking. Technology that can help you integrate crowdsourcing, wisdom of the crowds, more efficiently at a concept level rather than making a product prototype. So it is possible through analytics, through technology, etc., to manage that cost of disruptive innovation in a meaningful manner. But I think it is important to recognize that it will take some investment and dedicated resources to make that a reality for organizations.
I mean, but take Zuzu, for example. I mean, there is, Ram, you've got to admit, there was a possibility that Zuzu might not have clicked.
Now, if you just go back to speaking to folks in terms of the Zuzu story, you know, when the storyboard was presented with X-shaped characters, you know, nobody would have really thought that they'd like to put their money on it, because it really doesn't sound very fascinating in today's world to have some X-shaped character and do something. So stepping out of the comfort zone, taking a risk, more importantly, believing in your agency, because it's the end of the day, a creative director who's putting his money on it and he's saying that, no, I want to go behind this idea and I want to do it. So having that is very, very important. And I think once you believe in the idea, you've got to be really passionate to go all out. You know, then you have to really make sure that you create a huge impact by taking it all the way rather than, you know, limiting it at any point in time. So that's...
Well, David, when you're talking about non-air-conditioned malls, you must choose your city carefully, because I can tell you, when we don't have electricity at home, the safest place to go to for air conditioning is the mall, and I'm sure many other people do that. So may work in Bangalore, but not in other parts of the country necessarily. We've got about 15 minutes, well, maybe 10, to take some questions. We're running a little behind schedule, but I'd encourage you to just get up, introduce yourself, and you know, if you have any specific question for a panelist, shoot.
Roshni, I want to know, does Disney feel that it's ready now to come up with their own individual stores, you know, rather than being within malls or partnering with brands? Is India the market now to accept Disney in a bigger way?
We're not doing any stores in the country, clearly, because for us, I think we're just at the start of the entire retail revolution, as we all see. We have a lot of partners that we work with, from hypermarkets in the country like Big Bazaar to formats like Lifestyle, to Hamleys, to Crosswords, and we truly believe that each of these partners provide a lot of value back to us, just in terms of the kind of footfalls that they bring and allow us to experiment within their stores. So we truly believe we have the best of both worlds today, and we don't want to upset the process.
Sure.
I'm Shantanu from Future Brands. I have a question for Naren and Ram. Now, it was very interesting to know how you sort of build towards an innovative culture. But my primary question is, what is the life of that innovative culture once the innovation fails? And I'm coming from two examples. One is, of course, iPod, which really took off. And the other could be Vodafone, while the communication was extremely innovative. But the service, 3G service, hasn't really delivered. So how do you sort of build on once you failed? And are there strategies that you actually employ? Or, you know, it's good to say that you have a lot of courage behind the idea, but once it fails, what do you do about it?
I think it's a very good question. See, in any process like this, when you're introducing a new service like 3G, it's going to take its time in terms of adoption, you know. And yes, the campaign was brilliant. It led to a lot of trial. But the reality and confronting brutal facts, we have only 3 million 3G customers of 152 million subscribers that we have today across the country. So it's a very small penetration. We still are a voice country. Indians love to talk. So we still connect with each other on voice and SMS and 2G. That's where it is. So I think the more important point is, do you really establish your concept of 3G? So there are customers who are smartphone users who are upgrading, and especially with the younger generation, which Naren spoke about. You do see today among smartphone users a greater adoption for 3G, a greater adoption for these services. But I think the single biggest barrier is pricing. I think we have to make it much more affordable. And that's where we are challenged at this point in time. How do we really, you know, because this is a consumption story. You have to really open it up in such a way that you can actually make it accessible for a lot of people, which means you have to make it very price friendly. So today, if you really look at it, it's still 2G, which rules the roost in that sense. It's still not moved to that age. But I think, like we've seen in other opcos across the world, like we see in Egypt, we've clearly seen there's a shift that happens at some point in time. There's an inflection where 3G picks up.
But, you know, just to paraphrase your question, you know, are you also asking, so what happens to the innovation? And in this case, Zuzu, I mean, does it have a shelf life which continues
more
despite?
More importantly, the innovative culture, because once you fail, yeah, you really, you know, you're...
So I think just a couple of thoughts on that innovation culture. I really believe that this culture and mindset of there are times when you should not listen to customers and also push the boundaries on everything that you're doing is hugely important. And I'll give you two examples. One is Google. Google apparently allowed for 10% of the time their employees can work on whatever they want to work on. And there's no sort of a consumer in briefing to them. So that's a great example of how that is an endemic part of the culture. Similarly, for us at Yum, I talked about this achieving breakthrough results training that we do up and down the organization, which therefore anchors the conversations, every conversation that we have with people around three aspects. to have breakthrough results? Do you really have the desire for it? Do you have the knowledge and the know-how for it? And are you taking sufficient action? And are you thinking big enough? So that becomes almost like a ongoing vocabulary or conversation almost in everything that we do. So I think culture is absolutely important. Along with that, I think this nuance of making mistakes is good. You know, it's good to make mistakes. I think failure is a good thing. I think that, you know, we are tolerant of mistakes. And what we want is actually almost like a funnel approach, but where the top of the funnel is very broad, and then it narrows down with process and discipline and technology. But you want the width of the funnel to be as broad and possible to ideate constantly. And there, of course, you allow people, you know, a lot of freedom to make mistakes, etc. But this requires commitment absolutely from the top, and where you build in a culture that it's okay to make mistakes, and it's okay to actually sometimes not to listen to customers.
Okay, the pounding music next door is telling us that we have one last question.
So, question for Naren. As you grow multiple cities, many brands, owned and franchise, how do you really drive that culture down, not only in your own organization, but in the franchisee organizations, down, you know, to the bottom level? And is that a challenge, and what are the kind of things you do to overcome the challenge more, to say, at the franchisee level, not at the Yum level?
So I think we have this mindset of, you know, one system mindset, irrespective of ownership, the experience for the consumer and the employees should be the same. But that sounds easier than it, you know, in reality it might be. What therefore it means is that you have to be absolutely ruthlessly honest to the kind of partners that you choose, that the partners are totally aligned with the value systems that you have, and they also believe in building business the right way. And only then is it possible. And by partners, I mean the actual owners have to truly believe in it. Once that aligned, therefore the selection of the partners, I think, is the most important thing. I think the rest is a matter of detail. If you get the right partners, I do believe that it is possible, even in a franchise system, to have people who treat employees the same way, have built a similar culture, and have a very similar language that permeates the organization.
Okay, we're all out of time, but thank you very much for the presentations. They were great fun, and that's not a word that I use often. So thank you. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.